What's going on, everybody? I'm Pastor Chris, the online pastor here at CL, and I just want to say thanks for checking out Covenant Love Church right here on YouTube. We've got a great message today, but do me a quick favor and subscribe to this channel. Why, you ask? So you can be one of the first to know when we have a new message up or a new video online that's ready for you to view. And with that, let's jump right into the message.
Praise God. My assignment this afternoon is to speak to you about what are you confessing? Last week, Pastor talked about what do you see? This is, what do you see? What he talked about last week, this is the second portion of what are you confessing? Because if you're not confessing the right thing, you're not going to be able to see the right thing, which is so vitally important. And we'll talk a little bit about that. Father, I just thank you in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Lord, we just thank you in advance what you've already done. You've already met needs. You've already revealed yourself to people. You've made a way for a lot of people, Lord. We just thank you for that. And I'm asking you right now, Father, that hearts are open, that minds are receptive, that you will give me clarity of speech to be able to speak your word, that when it goes out, Father, it will be like rivers of living water, meeting everybody, whatever need they have, your word will meet it. And we just thank you in advance for that. Holy Spirit, help me. I thank you in advance. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Many people, even though they are saved, discover the power of their words and make the power work for them. You can find somebody that's not even saved and say, I'm going to do well, I'm going to achieve, I'm going to be successful. And they say it enough and they eventually become that. Or you can take a person that's saved and everything that comes out of their mouth, well, I can't do it. I don't know how I'm going to make it. They're talking death versus life. And what we as believers have to understand is that we are imprisoned by our negative words. Listen, what I'm saying, in other words, whether you speak good or evil, it's dependent on how you're going to live this life. If you're speaking negative, that's what you're going to receive. If you're speaking the word of God, that's what you're going to receive. You're controlled by your tongue, and we're going to talk a lot about that. One of the major problems with believers today is speaking words carelessly. Words of death and destruction. I mean, you just stop and just listen to people. I mean, they are gossiping and talking about people. You know, they pull up at the red light. I don't know why they're driving that type of car. I don't know why they didn't fix their hair this morning. Why you can't just bless them? Praise God. I thank God they're driving that car. Lord, I thank, bless God. Look at their hair. Father, that's a new style or something. You know, you talk to God about that. Understanding the power of your words and how it works and how it connects to your future is very important. It's very important. Because I'm going to tell you the truth. Where you are right now in life is what you spoke yesterday, your words. Where you're going to be tomorrow is what you're speaking right now. So you want to make sure that it's lining up with the word of God. And the Father, he's given us the key. It's 1 inch below your nose. It's your tongue. It's your mouth. He didn't say that you have to go out and climb the highest mountain or swim the widest sea. No, no, he said the only thing you have to do if you want to be successful and live a victorious Christian life is watch what's coming out of your mouth. You watch what's coming out of your mouth, it will literally control your destiny for good or bad. And that's really important. And we as believers have to make sure that we're not like the world. We're speaking like the world, saying what the world speaks. Because you're going to get that. We're from heaven, from another world. We need to speak what heaven say into this world and change everything that's going on. Let's go quickly over to James 3. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to have a good time. James 3:1, taming the tongue. Jesus saying this, my brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment. And basically what he's saying is, he said, being a teacher, you know, or an instructor, is not trying to be a big shot. It's being that you got responsibility. And if you use that responsibility for wrong, you're going to suffer some punishment for it. But if you use it for right and you help people, then you're going to be rewarded. So most people around, they want to be something, well, I've been called to be this, or they got their cards, I'm going to teach. Listen, you don't have to tell nobody what you are. The calling to come forth, what you are, which is vitally important. For we all stumble in many things. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man. Some translations say mature man. That means that if I can just bridle my tongue, I can literally be perfect. I can control everything that happens in my life. Also able to bridle the whole body. Indeed, we put bits in horses' mouth that they may obey us, and we turn their whole body. Look also at ships. Although they are so large and are driven by fierce winds, they are turned by a very small rudder wherever the pilot desires. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. See how great a forest a little fire kindles. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. You remember just last year they had all the fires going on out in California? What happened was one of the transformers, it sparked and it hit some brush, and thousands and thousands of acres and thousands of homes just got consumed off of that spark. And see, most people don't understand that your words that you speak, it's going to provide destruction if you're not speaking the right words. That's what's going to happen in your life. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire by hell. If you have a mouth that's continually speaking and is not speaking the word of God, it's probably controlled by hell. That means it's controlled by demonic influences. That's what it's saying. He keeps giving us examples and examples. He said, look, first of all, it's like a bit in a horse mouth. You put that bit in that horse mouth, I don't care how big or how strong he is, a 2,000-pound horse, you can turn him left or right, do whatever you want with him. He said, your words are like a rudder on a ship. You can take the largest aircraft carrier. It got a small rudder. And it turns that ship wherever it would like to go. And it said, your word is like a fire, like a spark that goes out and it kindles and just destroys. So we have to be careful of what's coming out of our mouth. You know, my mother used to tell me all the time, son, watch what's coming out of your trap. That's what she called my mouth, a trap. She said, watch what's coming out. And she said, you ought to speak good things, not bad things. I ain't know anything about that then, you know. I just said the first thing came to my mind. And what she was trying to teach me is that a thought may come into my mind, but if I don't give voice to it, it dies. But when I give voice to it, it comes alive. So that's what demonic influences would like to do. They bring the thoughts in, they want you to speak it. Now, I know most people don't believe what I'm saying. Oh, Pastor Robin, we all can't watch our words. I'm going to just say whatever I want to. Well, just go on. Because I see a lot of people that are hung by the tongue. Because they're using words carelessly. I mean, just lying when they don't have to. Speaking when they don't have to. If you're in a room with a group of people and they think it's something wrong when everything is quiet. No, it isn't. Sometimes you need to just think about what you're going to say before you say it. And if it's not lining up with the word of God, you shouldn't say it. Mm-hmm. That's true. Let's continue with verse 7. Again, real quiet, but that's okay. I'm going to believe God that it's going in. For every kind of beast and bird of reptile and creature of the sea is tame and has been tamed by mankind. But no man can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Now, that does not mean that we can't tame the tongue anyway, because if that was so, why would he be talking to us about it? What he's basically saying is, you can't control my tongue, and I can't control yours. The only person that can control our tongues is us by the power of the Holy Spirit. That's it. Because if not, it will just run wild, and it'll cause all kind of destruction in your life. And I'm going to say by faith, since I believe in what I say, that many of you are going to leave out of here and implement exactly what the Holy Spirit is saying this morning, and you're going to see your life change immediately. You're going to see it. It's so important. And I believe what I say, so I know we're going to see that. Verse 9, with it we bless our God and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the similitude of God. Blessing, and then all of a sudden, next thing you turn around, you're cursing. You know, I mean, I worship God, but then turn around and I curse my brother and sister. Well, no. That shouldn't be. The only thing that should come out of our mouths is one thing. It's blessing and blessing and blessing. No cursing. None whatsoever. And don't come and telling me that, you know, I just grew up like that, or where I grew up at. I'm just talking like that. No, you make a choice to what come out of your mouth. I just can't control my mouth, Pastor Robert. Well, you heard what we said. I wonder if you're saved then. That's what I'm going to ask. You can't control your tongue. You might not be saved. Out of the same mouth proceeds blessing and cursing, my brethren. These things ought not to be. Does a spring send forth fresh water and bitter water from the same opening? No. Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olives, or a grapevine bear figs? No. Thus, no springs yield both salt water and fresh. Now, let's define blessing. You hear people say it all the time, and they use it so loosely. I thank the Lord he's delivered me from it. When I hear him say it, I don't too much pay attention to it. And they always say, bless you, bless you, bless you. They meet a stranger, bless you, bless you, bless you. Listen, they are not, no faith behind, no power behind it at all. It's religion. That's what it is. Bless you, bless you, bless you. Now, when you want to bless somebody, you look them right in the eyes, you grab them by the hand, you say, bless you in the name of Jesus. You release something into their lives. And you ought to do that with your children too. What is blessing? Let's define it. Blessing is speaking well, good, the power and the ability to speak increase, to succeed, to multiply, to prosper, and to make happy. So whenever you say, in the name of Jesus, I bless you, you're saying, I want you to prosper. I want you to multiply. I want you to increase. That's what you're saying. Everybody understand that? You're saying that over them. You ought to be speaking it, like I said earlier, over your children. You ought to just lay a hand on your children sometime and say, listen, come over here. In the name of Jesus, I bless you that you will be the above and not beneath. I bless you with a lifelong peace of the Holy Spirit. I release into your life now, you are intelligent, you are beautiful. You release that into their lives. Because when you do that, guess what happened? It comes in. And I look, let me caveat this because I know somebody's going to want to send me an email or something. I love doctors. Especially Christian doctors. I love them. And doctors are there to give us what we need to be praying for. But if a doctor give you a report and the word of God say something different, believe the word of God. Believe the word of God. Begin to speak the word of God. Release the word of God in the situation. Do what the doctor tells you to do, but release the word of God in there and see what begins to happen. And what is cursing? We're talking about blessing and cursing. Now, most people think cursing is a four-letter word. Yeah, well, you can, you know, use that. Some people say that, okay. Or they call it profanity, if you want to get technical about it. Let's define it. Cursing is to utter a wish of evil against one, to imprecate, pray evil upon, to call for mischief or injury to fall upon, to separate. You know what cursing is? Nothing more than witchcraft. That's what that is, right? Whenever you're using your tongue to speak death, not life, that's what you're doing. You're calling it into your own life. I don't know why. I ain't never, ever been able to, I'm not smart. My mama told me I wasn't smart. True story. One of my teachers told me when I was growing up. He said he grew up with this young man, and they named him Zero. His parent named him Zero. This is what he said. He told me. He said, the teacher was Mr. Franklin. He said, you know what? He said, the kids used to tease him, hey, nothing. Zero. Nobody. And I said, what happened to him? He said, that's what he became. Nothing to nobody. Because they label him with that. Basically, they basically cursed that kid. And the parents may didn't know it, I don't know. But we as believers, we should know better. We should only speak life and blessing and blessing, nothing else. I'm telling you, you shouldn't do it. If you're speaking something else, the vision Pastor talked about last week said, what do you see? It's affecting what you're seeing. Because your what you see inside is formed by your words, good or bad. And if you're speaking the wrong words, you have an image that's not a godly image. And it's going to come in, just a matter of time. But let me give you an example of what speaking, what cursing is. Instead of speaking increase, you're speaking what? Decrease. Instead of when you get a bad report that you are, the Bible says you're healed, you say, no, I'm sick. Or you say, my Alzheimer, my diabetes, my arthritis. Now listen to me. If you go home in the evening, and we don't watch it at our house, and I'm sure it's still going on, they probably haven't changed it. In the evening around 6 o'clock, probably about 6 to 9, you watch that TV, and the majority of the things that shows up there are medical commercials. And people sit there on a diet and be fed that. Well, you know, if you woke up this morning and you had a pain in your back, it may be a symptom of you got a bad heart. Contact your doctor. Or, you know, your finger began to hurt or something. Or you might got arthritis in your finger. You need to contact your doctor. And before they was watching that, you know, all that stuff being fed to them, they were feeling fine. At the end of the night, they feeling, man, I need to go see a doctor or something. Because you let that medium there put all that stuff in your heart. And you have to fight against that. No, the best thing to do, click. That's not me. I don't know who they talking about. I'm healed by the stripes of Jesus. And now, Pastor Robert, they just, you know, I can't do without TV. They just make me so mad. Or Pastor Robert, I hear what you're saying about speaking these words. Who can do that? Well, what you're basically saying is you chose to do something else. It's a choice. I can choose to speak life or I can choose to speak death. And I'm gonna tell you folks in the military too, don't believe that lie. You know, you hear, well, you cursing like a sailor. No, you cursing because you want to. And some of you enjoy it too. And that's why we got to check up on you. Because it's been proven that if you use a lot of profanity or you use any profanity, it shocks your system. Every time you use a word or something, it shocks your system. That raises your blood pressure, anxiety, fear, all kind of stuff come with it. And you just think, well, I'm just using these words. No. Those words are trigger so that the enemy can come in and have an import into your life. You can control your tongue if you want to. If you don't want to, you won't do it. And I'm going to tell you right now, listen, I used to use profanity before I got saved. My wife never heard me use profanity, but I used to use profanity. When I got saved, and I was saved before I met my wife, a week after I had got saved, one word came out of my mouth. And I'm telling you, that thing like cut me in the heart. And I began to repent. Since then, never ever used any profanity. I even had to, in dreams, I'm dreaming about something, and I don't even use profanity in dreams. I'm telling you right now. That's how you know you've been set free. But we got to move quick. Let's take a little stroll through the word of God in Proverbs to show you exactly how powerful and how important and critical that you speak the right words. Proverbs 6:2. You're a snare taken with the words of your lips. You're caught trapped by the speech of your mouth. Whoa. So I'm setting a trap for myself whenever I speak wrong words. Proverbs 12:6. The words of the wicked are a lying wait for blood, but the mouth of the upright shall deliver them. I don't care if you're standing and you have symptoms of defeat and it's looking you right in the face. You can stand with all good assurance and say, Lord, I want to thank you that I am healed. I am healed. I don't care what it looked like. I am healed. I am set free. Some people say, well, Pastor Rob, what if we leave on and go on to be with the Lord? Hey, listen, ain't no better place to go. Then you meet Jesus and he say, yep. You believing, but I want you to come on with me. I'm telling you, it's so important. Proverbs 12, 13:3. He who guards his mouth keeps his life, but he who opens wide his mouth comes to ruin. Proverbs 18:7. A self-confident fool, mouth is his ruin, and his lips are a snare to himself. I mean, that's strong there now. Basically, what the Bible says, if you talk too much and you don't control your tongue, you're a fool. That's what he's saying there. Don't get mad. I agree with the word. Don't write us no letters on this. Proverbs 21:23. Whoever guards his mouth and his tongue keeps his soul from trouble. His soul is his mind, his will, and his emotions. That if I can control my tongue, I can keep my mind intact, my emotion under control, my will under control. And don't ever do it. Give in to your emotions. Don't ever give in to your emotions. It takes practice to be able to do that. Because when something happens, or you get a phone call, and it's something dealing with your children, the first thing, oh God, oh God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, your emotion just got involved. What you should say, okay, thank you very much. Okay, what's going on? Bless God. This is what the word of God say about it. No harm shall come near my children. My children are blessed with long life and health in the name of Jesus. Because I'm telling you, whatever you say immediately is how it's going to go. And you control that. You control it. What does cursing sound like? I got up this morning. It was raining. I sure don't like that rain. I want to be, you know, it's Saturday. I want to be outside having a good time. And all this rain got to come in. Just mess me up. Then you walk and look outside and the paper guy didn't throw the paper on your porch. He threw it out by the road. Now you got to walk outside. Now I got to walk outside by that blankety blank road and pick up that paper. And I'm gonna call him and give him a piece of my mind. Then you go back in the house, you call, you know, the paper guy and somebody answers the phone, didn't have nothing to do with it. Then you let them have, that blankety blank brought my paper and dropped it off. Y'all want my business? Y'all better shape up. Then you leave the house, go to Walmart. You pull into the parking lot and you identify this parking spot, you are headed to it. Somebody else go right into it. Then here we go again, you mad. Blankety blank took my parking, you know, my parking spot. I ain't gonna put up with this. Now I got road rage. I'm gonna just block that car in. So all that's cursing. And you know how I got started? When you first woke up that morning, it was raining. That bothered you. And it kept snowballing from then on. This is how you got to do it. Something not right. You got up that morning, you said, it's raining outside. Well, praise God. I don't have to pay no water bill today for my grass. Ooh, I thank the Lord for bringing on now. And then you look outside and your paper out there, you grab the umbrella and say, hey, I'm going out and get my paper. I'm going to read what's just some good stuff going to be here today. Then you leave home and you go to Walmart and somebody cut you off and get your parking spot. You say, Lord, just bless them. I just sow it into them in the name of Jesus. And then you walk inside and somebody say, hey, we just want to bless you. Hey, we want to give you all that grocery you got. We just want to bless you with it. All because you wouldn't let death come out of your mouth. It was all life. And it was life coming out. It was a blessing coming out. You got to be able to do that. Because if you don't, you'll find yourself in trouble. I want you to remember this. I'm going to give you a phrase here. And I want you to remember it. If you speak it, it will be. If you speak it, it will be. Now look at your neighbor. Elbow him, wake him up. Look him in the eyes. Say, neighbor, if you speak it, it will be. Tell him again, say, did you hear me the first time? I said, if you speak it, it will be. And just to make sure you heard it, I'm going to say it one more time to you. Say, if you speak it, it will be. And look out for those words. You know, every time I get paid, my car breaks down. If you speak it, you know, every time I got to put up with all this attitude on this job today. If you speak it, I just don't know how I'm gonna keep working. I'm 80 years old. I ought to be retired by now. If you speak it, you know, I'm on a fixed income. If you speak it, you know, the doc said, by the time I get 75, I'm not going to be able to walk. If you speak it, you can switch all of that and you can get right back to where you need to be at by not speaking those things, because it promotes death. It brings death into your life. And you don't want that, I'm telling you right now. What you want, what the word of God say. Let's go quickly over to Proverbs 18, and we're getting ready to come into where we need to be at, and then we're going to get you out of here. Proverbs 18:20, they show you the power that you have with words. A man's stomach shall be satisfied from the fruit of his mouth. From the produce of his lips he shall be filled. Listen, he didn't say hard work or how intelligent you are. He said, your stomach shall be satisfied from the fruit of your mouth. I know people that have working themselves extremely hard. Diligence, the Bible said, I believe in diligence. I'm telling you right now. I believe in that. But what they do, they work, they have two or three jobs, but they're completely undermining themselves by the word that they speak. This job going to kill me. I don't know why I got to do all these. This is going to kill me. No. Won't you just shift and say, Lord, I'm believing for one job with great benefits. Angels are living God. Go out and bring it in. You're shifting it, see. You're shifting it around. But just remember, if you speak it, it will be. Verse 21, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it shall eat its fruit. I don't buy into that, Pastor Robert. Well, what you're basically saying is, I buy into something else. I made a choice to speak whatever I want to. But you got to be careful. And listen, whether it's you or me, if I am a believer and I see in the word of God where it say I need to make a change, regardless of how I grew up, my parents, my father, or whoever taught me, if it contradicts with the word of God, I got to lay it aside. And I got to take and do exactly what he said. I got to make that choice. I don't care what my religion said or whatever. You don't want that religion anyway. I've seen many people, they talk life, they go a little forward, and then they start talking death, and they go further back. And they wonder why I'm in this conundrum here, you know. I'm going around. It's your mouth. If you can bridle your tongue and speak only life, you'll be successful in everything you do. Everything. And you release the words of God to go along with it. Now, I want you to be careful. Look for these key words I'm going to give you right now. Everybody speak this. I only speak life. Some key words to watch out for. If you hear people saying these things, or if you saying them, be aware of them. One of the key words is, I get this. I get migraine. Every time around this time of the year, I get the flu. You know, when I get, you know, my dad died when I was 50. When I get 50, I'm going to die too. And you know what? What the enemy does, he brings people or get you saturated with work with some type of vision in your mind, and you'll get there and you'll just take off at 50 years old. Nothing wrong, you just die. Because you've spoken it so long. Another word, this happens to me. You're decreeing something over your life. You're prophesizing. This always happened to me. I don't know why. But everybody else can be blessed, but I'm always behind. I'm never going to be out front. This always happened to me. Even when I go to the restaurant, I'm always going to get a chair where I don't want to sit at. It always happened to me. If it can happen to anybody, it's going to happen to me. Be careful of that. Another key word, that causes me to get angry, to get frustrated, to get into sin. When people say stuff like that, I don't care who they are, I'm a man. We're gonna have to fight. No. You gotta be aware of that kind of stuff. Because that's sin. You don't wanna do that. Now, I'm not telling you if somebody jump on you, get them off you so you can minister to them. I'm telling you that now. You get them off of you so you can minister to them, but don't inflict no unnecessary harm. No, but the truth is, you shouldn't be in that position. Well, you know, I heard one guy came, we was in another building, he said this, you know, my wife, she just made me so mad, and he had been, physically abusing his wife a little bit. He said, that's what he said a little bit. That's what he said. He said, she just made me so angry. And I looked him in the face, I said, if I said the same thing your wife said, you wouldn't do nothing to me, would you? He looked at me, well, no. You know, because he know what he saw? I wasn't going to do what his wife did. His wife was, she was a small lady, bigger than he, big guy. And I said, no, you can control that. The challenge is you don't want to control it. I said, but if I said the same thing your wife said, you wouldn't do anything to me. I said, because you know what would happen. You know? And he said, oh, yeah, I know what would happen. But the key is you, no, it's a choice. Beware of those words. That causes me. Or another big one is I can't. I can't do it. I can't make it. No, you can. As soon as you let that out of your mouth, you're already defeated. I can't learn that. Yes, you can. You have the mind of Christ. You can do all things through Christ. Father, I thank you right now that I am intelligent. I have the mind of Christ. And I receive everything I need. And then you start doing your part. Every time I get paid, or every time I get over there by them folks, this is what normally happens. Be careful of those words. All those key words will mess you up. It always does this, or it always does that. What happens? You release death. Now you say, Pastor Robert, what do I say? An example. I always get migraines. No, that's the wrong way to say it. I have had migraines. I don't care if it were 2 minutes ago. I have had migraines because what's happening is it's not going to hurt your future. It's in your past. You know, I used to get angry when people said stuff like that. No, I don't get angry anymore. I used to, but God delivered me from that. Now I just look at them and smile. Be more accurate in what you're saying and your communication because it won't hurt your future. But if you turn around and every time you turn around, you're just spitting out of your mouth, you're just letting your flesh take over your emotions, I'm telling you right now, you are digging a hole that you'll put yourself in with your own mouth, and you can't do that. You don't want to do that. Who do we think he is? Somebody just thought that probably. Who do Pastor Rob think he is saying that to us? I'm trying to help you. I love you, man. I love you now. See, what happened is there are spiritual influences all around us, angels, demons. When we release words, they're going one or two directions. Angels of the living God, a demonic spirit going to take those words. You ever thought, good example, thank you for that Holy Spirit. Whenever you sit down, I used to have this problem all the time. When I want to sit down at home and start studying my Bible, before then I can be watching TV. Nothing, I'm just usually watching TV. As soon as I say, hey, I'm going to start studying, hey, you need to get up and go cut grass. You need to go, there's something back in the back, you need to go fix something around your house. You don't need to be studying. You know why? Because they're trying to get me to get away from the life. But when you, and this is what I said that day, and never had any problem with it. I said, you demonic spirit, you every devil of hell, you listen to me right now. I got mad. I said, I don't care if this house burned down. I'm not moving from this table until I get through. That settled it. No more problem out of that. But what you got to do, they are around you trying to influence you to go a different direction than the way the Father say go. And if you are not wise, you'll go the way of the world. And people always say this. Well, you know, everybody doing that. I thank God Jairus didn't do that. When he met Jesus and the woman with the issue of blood, and Jairus' daughter had died 12 years old. And then all of a sudden, one of the people from the came and said, she's dead. Don't even bother Jesus anymore. Bible said Jesus looked at Jairus and said, Jairus, believe only. Jairus didn't say not one word. Because he knew. Jesus knew it. If Jairus kept believing, I can go and raise her from the dead. But all of a sudden, Jairus said, oh my God, she's dead. She's not going to be away. She's not coming back. That was it. But he said, stop. Jairus, believe only. And you know what happened? Got set free. I'm telling you, it's so important that you and I speak the words. I'm going to read this last scripture here, and then we're going to get ready to close. In Psalms 12, verse 1. Help, Lord. You ever felt like that? That's all you got to say. You need help, Lord. I just need some help. For the godly man ceases, for the faithful disappear from among the sons of men. One scripture said, when Jesus returns, will he find faith? They speak idly, useless, unnecessary words. Everyone with his neighbor with flattering lips and a double heart they speak. You know what a double heart is? They speak in what they don't believe. And they can change at any time. They are saying things they don't believe. May the Lord cut off all flattering lips and the tongue that speaks proud things. Now, this is key. Focus on that one. Who have said, with our tongue we will prevail, our lips are our own. Who is Lord over us? What they're basically saying is this. That my lips belongs to me. I control me. And I want to tell you this. That if God is not Lord of your lips, he's not Lord over you. No such thing as you can't control it. You can. And we can. Just think about this. What if every word that you spoke came to pass? How different would your life be? Just think about it. If every word that you spoke, only words of life that you desired to come into your life, how different would your life be? Every word God speaks come into existence. Every word we should speak should come into existence. Me personally, in my own household, I watch my word. And my wife and I, we got a pact. I said, if I say something that's not bringing life, you know what I say? This is what you asked me. You want me to get an agreement with those words. And that triggered me. I said, what did I say? I said, oh, no, I bind that in the name of Jesus. Or if she say something, I do the same thing. I say, you want me to get an agreement with that? What did I say? Oh, no, I don't want that. We're not going to speak that. You have to measure your words according to the word of God. And I'm going to tell you right now, whatever you're desiring, whatever you believe in God for, it all begins with confession. Confession precedes possession. That if I speak the word of God, I will have it. If it don't show up tomorrow, don't bother me at all. I'm going to keep on speaking it because I know it's coming. It's coming. Just a matter of time. The Bible says this. Those who inherit the promises of God inherit them by faith and patience. I got to make sure that I have the faith. I've released it, and I just need a little patience. It'll come in every single time. Every word we speak is vital. What do you see? What are you speaking? What are you confessing? Just think about it. If every word that I spoke came to pass, how would my life be changed? When your kids are sick, you don't need to be in the valley or wondering if what I speak now going to work. Are you believing for healing? You've been speaking like something you shouldn't have been spoken. And you try to speak the word of God? No. It should be one thing. When I release my faith, bless God, it's going to work because I'm the same all the time. When I lay hands, the anointing going to flow. When I rebuke, it's going to be rebuked. because there's no difference. So it's vitally important that we understand how vital it is what we're speaking. If I'm not speaking life, I am speaking death. I am speaking death. Everybody get something out of this?
Thanks again for joining us here on YouTube. I believe that God had something special just for you today. And maybe you were listening to the message and thought of someone who also needs to hear it. Then please feel free, as always, to use this video as a ministry tool and share it with them today. And if you ever need more information about CL, be sure to check out our website. It's super easy to remember, mycl.church. And if you're ever in town, we would love for you to come to church and say hey. But if you're not in Fayetteville, you can always check out our church online, which happens every Sunday morning at 8:30 and 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. I look forward to seeing you there. Thanks again for joining us. Until next time, I'm Pastor Chris.